wife's last name, and we combined it with my name. I'm American, so my original name is Paul Joynt. I'm going to talk about blockchain, why it's simple, and why it's smart for financial services organizations like Nets, where I work, to deal with it. A lot of people today have been talking about, you know, the trust element that, okay, as long as you have a blockchain, there you can trust anyone on the blockchain, open, permissionless. I'm not going to get into all of that. I think that's been covered greatly today. But one of the basic pillars of financial services today is that there exists trust in the institutions that actually provide financial services. One of the things that I think is really, really cool about blockchain and other stuff is that there's some new technology that it's come along that will enable financial services companies to interact in different ways that they have been doing, but also in ways that they haven't envisioned, and that's really cool. We're all following the news, you know, with the Panama Papers and transparency and all that cool stuff, and I really liked your talk about the legal aspects of open source and all those things. We do some thinking around that. But transparency is really a key word moving forward. But what really caught my attention was way back, and it was actually back in 1994, so I've been waiting for this blockchain thing for a long time. Nick Szabo, he wrote this great stuff about smart contracts back in 1994. And it was pretty groundbreaking stuff. And actually what it was about having computer programs interact with real world assets. And, you know, his theory was really, really good. And you can go on the web and read it. And it's really fascinating that he came up with that. Was on the back thought of the internet and those things. But what it really, what we really can see now is you can automate and demystify what was the essence of smart contracts. But what was desperately in need was, you know, it was a thought process for Nick Szabo to write about smart contracts. But you really needed a digitally native system or solution like blockchain. Now we've talked about Ethereum and all sorts of other platforms. I'm not going to get into that, but now the tools are there to be able to implement smart contracts that actually make sense. And I think that where we're going to see the biggest proliferation is actually in the Internet of Things. And I like to call it that will quickly become the Internet of Banking Things. Because if you can give mandates to the things that you own to operate on your behalf, that's a really cool thing. And we do that very often. We have direct debit solutions, we have credit transfer solutions where there are mandates. These are traditional financial services products. But once you get Internet of Things and you start getting smart contracts that you can give a mandate to operate on your behalf, I mean, wow, the sky is the limit. But these smart contract platforms aren't easy. So Ethereum, cool, they've come a long way, but there was this Codeus that was some way back that fell through. Don't really know why, but not really widespread adoption, but Ethereum is there now. But the real thing is smart contracts is what I believe is going to be the smart thing to do for financial services. And the times are changing. Because what financial services providers used to be able to do back then was delay created opportunity. So we've all heard, you know, the finality of payments taking 1 to 3 days. Though that delay in sending these funds and doing that, that created an opportunity to pay a premium price for transferring money across the world. Not many people like to talk about that, but that's a reality. And there were a lot of friction barriers. What we see now is transparency and blockchain and Bitcoin and all of these things. Now it's about instant. Now things should cost as little as possible. They should be available at any given time. And the financial transaction should be really, really fast. And how do you get that? You only get that if you create an environment with smooth collaboration. Now, working in the financial industry, I think I can suffice to say that smooth collaboration isn't what really has been the norm factor for us. We spend a lot of time trying to do things, but the speed needs to pick up. And I like to think about it like this. You have to simplify things and you have to collaborate. And picking up a stone, like I told my son while we were on holiday this summer, I said to him, okay, if you can put 7 stones on top of each other and balance them, I'll buy you an ice cream. Now you guys go home and you try to do that on your own, balance 7 stones on top of each other where the bottom one is biggest. It's virtually impossible if you don't get a team of people together and collaborate. This is an old Japanese thing. Go home and try it with your kids or knock yourselves out and have fun. But the thing is, in terms of creating financial services applications like smart contracts, you need developers, you need some type of financial institution, you need service providers, you need processors, and all of these need to collaborate together. And the only way that we can get this done is if we do that. It's smart, yet it's elusive. So collaborative value creation is what I'm talking about. Payment or financing, as Chris Skinner was talking about, Dr. Spock never pulled out his wallet. It's increasingly becoming that payment or financing or doing this is supposed to be a non-event. I think that's great. It's a non-event. It's the value creation and the value transfer that is important. And this creates transparency. But think about what happens when your fridge, your car, or your drone is given a mandate to act financially upon your behalf. Whoa, that's some really cool stuff. And that opportunity is there for financial institutions to grasp. The smart contracts have been there since 1994, but now the technology is there. And I like to think of it as, you know, trade finance, where you have a long chain of things happening. It can actually be trade finance-like experience, but just for consumers. Because we all know that the financial services, they often go after the consumer behavior first in order to create penetration and create, you know, really cool stuff that works. But I also work a lot in payments, and I know that reality hits you. And if you really want to take the blockchain to the next level, and if you want to make your smart contracts work, and you want to hook to the last mile, which is, there's a number of financial institutions here. We talk about Bitcoin and all of those things, but the last mile where you get your money from your account and all the technology that banks have there, that last mile is very, very, very complicated and very costly. And in order to work forward, I think everyone that wants to do something inclusive in blockchain also needs to think about how to induce ISO 20022, which is a standard that the financial service industry has been working a long time to adopt. I think this is something, if you combine the smart contract, the blockchain, ISO 20022, that's going to be a real killer stuff. We had a panel a little earlier today about the identity is a massive sort of source of value. I think this is really underrated as well. The identity aspect of blockchains and financial services, combine that together and you'll get a revenue stream where you can do. You really need to focus when you do these things, and I'm just racing through this because I know we're at a little bit of challenge in terms of time. But so what are we doing at Nets? I just wanted to bring you up to speed a little bit on that. So what we're looking at is we're looking at how we can do things across borders. There's a lot going to happen with PSD2 and opening up accounts. We're looking at how you can do things across borders and not only domestically, even though smart contracts will probably be something that happens both domestically on a global scale. Cryptocurrency acceptance, I think this is something that's just going to become the norm pretty quick. So we've done that in a number of our payments products, that you can actually accept bitcoins and some other type of cryptocurrencies. In terms of mandates, and that's what I really think is the important thing, because you might not realize it, but whenever you use your mobile bank or your net bank, sometimes you give mandates to the to other people to operate on your behalf. And those mandates are really key in how you can create an environment where smart contracts can thrive and survive. And distributed ledgers, we're looking into that. I think it's really, really early days on that one, so I don't want to really comment too much on there, but there's certainly going to be things there. But at the end of the day, it's about collaborations, and if you got some great ideas and want to talk, smart contracts are good, ISO 20022 is good. Let's create reach and have a good time doing it. Thank you.